Well, for this edition of my e-magazine, I've come to Gold Valley on Middle Lake. Peg 79, it's a fantastic little area to show you the two methods that have really come to the fore, not just here, but on a variety of venues across the country, especially for F1s and small carp. We've had a real good stocking here at Gold Valley, just under 18,000 fish gone in Middle Lake alone. So hopefully they'll play ball. And it really has turned into one of those quite good, solid, if you like, F1 lakes. The methods that I really want to show you today are really coming to the fore. The two methods I'm going to show you is long pole shallow, but what I'm going to try to do is make the jigger work. This has been a major success for me on a lot of venues through the year. If you don't know exactly how to do it, it can be a little bit daunting, and a lot of people back away from it just because it's not been explained. But today, I'm going to show you exactly how to do it, and hopefully these F1s will play ball. The second one, and it really is, in my mind, one of the most deadly ways of catching these big F1s and stockies that there really is, especially this time of year when you get a little bit of room on these venues, especially on midweek venues, and that's fishing paste really close. Now, what this enables me to do is, paste is a little bit of a nightmare bait really, because if you're fishing long and you're fishing for lots of fish, obviously you're going to miss bites. That means coming back, baiting up after every missed bite. It's okay if you're catching a few obviously as well, but it's going to slow you down. So what I like to do with paste is to make it user friendly, stack things in my favour. And one thing I'm going to show you today is catching really close on a top three. Now obviously this method, it doesn't work all the time. We've got a little bit of room today, hopefully we will catch on it. But in a lot of matches where it's every other peg, it can not only be a fantastic method to start on, because obviously if you can go in and start catching fish, you're going to be ahead of the game. But also if you go in and you're not catching, just enables you to keep your eyes and ears open and see what exactly is working without putting pressure on the rest of your peg. And as you all know, I'm a massive, massive fan of that. Obviously, if you don't catch early, then it can be a fantastic method for really catching well in that last hour. When the fish are confident, when you know that they're really going to start having a go that last hour and they come in, you can really rattle them out quickly close. One of the best things about it, and this is something that a lot of people don't realise, is you don't miss as many bites. And this is because when your float's in and it goes under, because it's so close to you and you're virtually on top of your float, you can see what your float's doing under the water. The water's quite coloured here at Gold Valley, but you can still see what your float's doing under the water. And what that enables me to do is fantastic. When the float goes under, if it keeps going down, I'm going to strike. If it goes under and then just comes back up, that's a liner. But if I was fishing longer and couldn't see what was going on underneath the water, obviously I'd have struck, missed the bite, had to come in, and it all makes the whole process a lot slower. Obviously cuts your end weight down, makes you less efficient. So by fishing it close, obviously that is really going to speed things up. I'm going to show you the tackle that I've set up for today's session. I've set a couple of paste rigs up, just duplicates, they're exactly the same, so I'll only show you one. I've got three shallow rigs for when we go shallow, two conventional and a jigger. I still like to put conventional rigs up because when they're really having it, you can still catch them like this. One little thing I really want to touch on, and to me, it's vitally important. As you've probably gleaned now on a lot of the F1 features that I've done, I like to try and catch the fish really close to me so I can be fast, efficient. You almost don't need as many fish in your peg if you're catching them close because you can catch them so quick. And the one thing that is a definite plus to me is to tie your nets down. Always make sure that you've got plenty of water, the whole of the net submerged down to the bottom. But what you don't want, and it's called in the trade, when you've got a lot of fish in your net swims out and goes down the shelf. If you can imagine, I'm fishing a top three today and everything's going well, catch 20 or 30 pound early, I haven't tied my net down and my net swings round, it's going to be where I'm fishing and I don't want this to happen. So I've got two meter cords, one on each net, just tied round to the side. Always make sure though that your net is completely submerged and there's enough water in there. Don't have it up the bank because this isn't fish friendly. You need the whole net in the water on the bottom, but then tied round so it can't actually drift away. And this is a major advantage when you're looking to catch a lot of fish at close quarters. There's one little tip that for me is a massive plus, and I see a lot of anglers just not doing it. I'm going to go on to the rigs now. I'll start with the pace rig. I've got the orange hydro, the F1 hydro. Again, a lot of people get confused. If I was fishing for big carp with paste, then obviously you've got heavy elastic, heavy line, big hooks, bigger floats. With F1s, you've got to cut everything down, a bit like when we fish pellets, 012, 013, 16 hooks, lighter elastics, and paste is just the same. I've got a small pot situated on my pole. That's just for feeding the paste and for putting some loose offerings in. The beauty is when you're fishing on a top three, you can put the paste on and just lower it straight in. This is for when I start, when I want to feed a little bit, but again, the most important thing and the best thing with paste is you don't need to feed a lot. That's situated a foot and a half back from a pole, so my rig can just hang down. That's all little things you'll see when I start fishing. Orange hydro, again, is my number one choice for these style of fish. I've got 018 main line coming down to a carper paste, 4x14s. Again, it's a very strong, durable float that's been custom made for this style of fishing, and it is, in my opinion, the number one paste float on the market. Now, a lot of you might recall when I've done paste work before, I never shot the float. That's fishing for big fish on big lumps of paste where the float is going to get registered by the actual hook bait. A little bit different when we're fishing for F1s. I've got a bulk of shot, so the float is actually shotted full bristle. The rig is situated around about an inch to an inch and a half over depth. I've got an 013 hook length and a size 14 gamma pellet hook. Slightly bigger hook than say if we were fishing with soft pellets, but obviously much more scaled down than if we were fishing like conventional paste for big carp. My conventional paste rig would be 020, 022 to a size 12 or a 10 and not having any shot. But because we're using slightly smaller bits of paste that might not register the float totally, you do need to shot the float. Through the process of elimination and practicing, it really is the number one way of doing it. A nice little bulk, it hangs down prop absolutely perfect, and it just makes the whole thing much more efficient. You can see there I'm about an inch and a half over depth when you take into consideration I want the float dotted down. Again, I've marked the depth. If you do lose any fish, it's brilliant to come back and relate to it. You don't want to be messing around plumbing up. Not only is it going to slow you down, but it could spook feeding fish. I've got two of those rigs made up for close quarter pace fishing. You'll see when I actually start fishing the advantages of fishing so close, and hopefully if they play ball, just how quick you can catch them. Now I want to go on to the shallow rigs. We've got the wind off our back here today, and what I'm going to do when we start, I'm going to be fishing pace and I'm going to be pinging 4 mils, trying to build that up. The weather's gone quite cold overnights lately, but I'm convinced that with a little bit of hard work with the feeding, keeping it constant, might take an hour or two to get them going, I think we will catch a few shallow. And the two rigs I'm going to start off by showing you, you can see here I've got the F1 speed kit in the cloud version. Again, I'm a massive fan of using silver or white tops. Darwa, we've gone for a slightly silver color. Again, when I've been out testing these products, it's definitely been the best color, and in my mind, when I'm fishing 3 foot or shallower, even on the bottom or shallow, these are a massive plus. It cuts down any shadows and it really does increase your catch rate. Now, I'll just pop one down because it's a bit hard to hold them and go through them. The rigs are exactly the same. One set at 16 inches deep, one set at 12 inches deep. Just gives me a variety. Again, the orange hydro, my number one. Coming down to the float is a 4x12 carper shelf, my number one float for fishing for F1 shallow. It's strong, it's durable, it's got a little tip on it, which again makes it slightly more sensitive than say a conventional dibber. 015 main line to a little bulk. I've got a 10 centimeter hook length there of 013 down to an wide gape gamma katsu hook with a little band tied on. If I do start catching a lot of fish, I might well go on to a varnish pellet, which I've got already pre-tied, and that's something that I'll show you in a minute. They're the conventional rigs. You can see they're set at two different depths. One's at a foot, one's at 16 inches. They're the two depths that I really do like to catch at. Now you might notice that I have got quite a long line on both rigs. Again, I'm going to be flicking the rig over, using the hook bait to make noise and hopefully attract the fish. It's very hard to do that with a short line, and I find around 2 to 2.5 foot between float and elastic is the perfect length of line to give you that whip to get the rig going over. They're the two rigs, both on the F1 speed kits. Now the last rig I want to show you, again, this is for when they're really, really having it. And it's just a conventional jigger rig. You can see there, it's set 16 inches deep, which again is one of my favorite depths to catch fish. I can turn this over again, you're making the noise with the float. I can hold the float literally 6 inches deep. I can lower it down to a foot and then lower it down to 16 inches. Lift it out and repeat the process. I can tap a little bit as well if I want. But the jigger, again, it really has been brought home to me how good and how deadly this method is. And that's why I wanted to come here today, to show you the two methods that have really come to the fore and made me sit up and pay attention. Made me sit up and look around and say, hang on a minute, these guys are catching too many fish on these methods. I need to do that. And now I've had a go, it really is vitally important. And it's fantastic to come to a lake like this, it's absolutely stuffed full of fish, and show you a couple of methods that I think will really pay off for you on venues like this in the coming months. It's just a conventional jigger rig. I can fish at a variety of depths. It's going to make a nice big splash when I turn the rig over. And again, the same top, the F1 speed kit in the cloud version, just to give me that added camouflage if the fish do come shallow. Today's going to be about hard work, really trying to concentrate on that short line, but again, being aggressive and pinging that long line, keeping the bait going in really regular. When you're looking to catch these F1s and small carp shallow, you've got to feed regular, not only to draw them in your peg, but once you've drawn them in your peg, to keep them there. Just one little last thing for this style of fishing. When you do catch a lot of fish, it's worth just getting some varnish pellets done. You can see here, I've got a little hook length box with a variety of pellets in that have been varnished and super glued, put on a noose. They're really going to help me speed my catch rate up if I do get a lot of fish in my peg. I'm going to start on the conventional banded pellets. I'll be very quick to change to these if I feel I get a volume of fish in my peg. As far as the bait for today's session, it is quite simple. I've got some soaked micros, which are the fishery version. Again, they go quite rubbery, but very heavy. I'm going to use these in cooperation with the paste close to begin with. I want to kick start my peg with a few of these. I've not mixed loads up because what I intend to do is when the fish arrive on that close paste line is just use the paste. Even if the fish eats that ball of paste, there's going to be a little bit of cloud, a little bit of ground bait come off that. And also if I do miss any bites, I'm going to deposit that paste right there. And that's what I'm going to look. You don't need to feed loads to get these fish in your peg, and also one of the worst things you can do as far as missing bites and foul hooking fish is to feed too much. The paste is made from fishery pellets that I've literally just liquidized. Actually, I've used a blender because it really crushes them up. Just sieve it. And a lot of venues where I go and fish paste, the number one paste to use is made from the most popular pellets, and here at Gold Valley it's no different. It goes nice and sticky. You can see I've mixed it slightly on the wet side, and I'm going to be using slightly smaller bits of paste than we would do normally for carp. Around about the size of a bait bean, up to twice the size of a bait bean. Not these big gobstopper bits that we might use for carp, little tiny bits, but you'll see some little tricks as I go along that I'll talk you through as far as the paste is concerned, how to put it on the hook, and maybe even mixing up, or moulding up, sorry, little balls as I'm going along and as I'm fishing. One thing when you're paste fishing, as always, your bait can dry out, and I've just got a little cup here that's half full of water that I can just tip in the paste to get that desired consistency. I don't want it just falling off the hook really wet, but then again, I don't want it dry. That nice sort of pasty consistency that's going to grip on the hook. And a lot of times you'll see I won't be putting it in the pot, I'll be putting it on the hook and just dropping it in. Again, this is for speed. You need to catch a lot of fish on these style of venues, and by speeding the whole process up, this is exactly what you want to do. And if you have your paste too wet, it's just not user friendly, and it doesn't cut down on the amount of bites you get. I've got some 4mm pellets, nice and dark, always look for the slightly darker ones, especially if you're fishing shallow. Two or three reasons for this: the darker ones have got slightly more oil in, they're slightly heavier, they're going to fly better when you're loose feeding, you're going to group them better. Also, they all sink. I'll be using these banded, just picking out the slightly bigger ones for the band so it makes a little bit more noise and a little bit more visual. Nice and simple, three baits. It's more about the actual tactics and the way to do it today rather than having any fancy baits. On a lot of fisheries, and here is no different for F1s, it's not necessarily what you're doing it with, it's how you're doing it. The actual way that you do it, you know, the real sort of guts of the method. And if you can understand this and put it to good use, the bait isn't really important. You can use your favourite paste, your favourite pellets. The way you're doing it is vitally important. I can't wait to get started. I've shown you the bait, I've shown you the rigs, I've sort of talked you through the sort of thinking behind both methods. Now I think it's time to actually get fishing and try and make these methods work. And more importantly, prove to you just how deadly they are. Before I start, I just want to go through the process of hooking the paste on, because it is very important. You want to get the best purchase on the paste with your hook as possible. And although I'm fishing with smaller pieces of paste, it's very, very similar to when we fish for carp. I'll be laying the paste on my knee, cutting the line into the paste, centralising it, and then literally pulling the hook into the paste, moulding it round and just flattening the bottom of the paste so it'll go to the bottom and sit absolutely perfectly. If you just push the paste in the top, you're not going to get a good purchase. It's not going to stay on that long. But like I say, by putting it through and having the hook situated in the bottom of the paste, you're going to get a lot of purchase. And that can just be swung out when you're catching the fish or just dropped in the pot at the beginning of the session. Well, here I am. I've showed you the gear. I've talked you through what I'm going to try to do today and the reasons behind it. And just to recap, that close pace line on a top three, it's worked on a multitude of F1 venues and small carp venues that I've been to. And like I said earlier, you're making it easy for yourself. F1 fishing, especially when you're fishing with pace, is about making it easy for yourself. The further you go out, as I've already said, the more difficult it's going to be. Difference is, you miss a bite on pace, you've got to come in, rebait. When we're fishing really close, obviously then if we do happen to miss a bite, it's just rebaited, drop straight back in, and as simple as that. What I've done is I've put in about 50 micro pellets on the short line, and I'm going to start there on paste. If I have to, I'll work my way out, but I really want to try and make that work. Again, if you're fishing close to yourself, you don't have to catch as quick. Everything else speeds up. Obviously, repositioning the rig, baiting up, netting the fish, everything's really quick. So you could almost have a lot less fish close and end up catching more than if you fish further out. Like I've already said in today's article, or today's eMag, I'm going to couple the short pace line with trying to catch a few shallow, either on the conventional rig or the jigger. I'm going to loose feed 4 mils. And what I'm going to try to do is really get into a rhythm early on. Feeding, obviously short with the paste, feeding long with the 4 mil pellets at 14 and a half meters, and really try and get in the groove. So I've got a small bit of paste there, probably twice the size of a baked bean. Again, like I've already said when I went through the gear, everything's scaled down. The difference is we've got a little bit of shot on the line. Again, because these smaller bits of paste, they tend not to weigh the float down as much. And literally all I'm going to do is drop it in on the top three line, right where I've fed those few micros, and I'm going to start loose feeding fours out on that longer line. With this style of pace fishing, you don't need to feed a lot of bait. There's little bits coming off of that hook bait. If you do miss a bite, obviously that bait's deposited there. But the best thing about fishing pace at close quarters is you can actually see what your float's doing under the water. Might take a little time to build up, and all I'm going to do to begin with, to try and get a few fish in my peg, is to really see, I just struck the paste off there. That's another little bit of bait. The paste I'm using is just pure 100% ground fishery pellets. Here at Gold Valley, you don't have to use fishery pellets, but we do use it, and it's quite sticky. I don't have to put it in the pot. But early on in the session, while I'm trying to build the swim up, what I'm doing is I'm putting in a few micros in that pot, and just for accuracy, I'm not throwing them. And again, I'm getting in the rhythm of just feeding some four mils out there, building that shallow line up. And again, I'll be looking for any swirls. I had a little indication then on paste, as soon as it hit the bottom, which is a fantastic sign. And what I'm looking for is that quick bite, but also there's one there. Fantastic. And I could see what my float was doing. Only a very small F1. That's one of the smallest that we've got here at Gold Valley. But again, fantastic fishing. And you come to a lake like this, Middle Lake now, that's absolutely full of fish. It really does give you a brilliant sort of arena to show you exactly what to do. One other little trick, you'll notice that as I'm fishing with paste, when the rig's in, see now I've got some fish there, I literally just lower that paste in, let my float cock, I'm going to feed that shallow line, and then with my left hand, immediately I'm making up another little, just a bit bigger than a pea size bit of paste. You can see there while I'm watching the float, and that can just be placed on my side tray, and it just speeds the whole process up. A lot of these venues, you're looking to catch quite a lot of fish. Anything like that, just to speed you up, can really, really help you. Just going back to what I was saying about looking down on the float. When you're fishing at close quarters, when the float dibs and it goes under, you can almost see what it does under the water, and if it keeps going or if it stops and just, there you go, that like that bite then. The float went under and I could see it keep going under the water. And when you're fishing at close quarters, it's a fantastic, fantastic way of doing it. When I hook a slightly bigger one like this, and I know it's going to take a bit of time to get in, I'm going to loose feed my shallow line as well. That's a lovely F1 there. It's really taken that bait down just inside its mouth. You can see there, them slightly bigger F1s. If you can get these lined up on paste or shallow, you're going to have a weight. Since I've been doing a few articles on F1s, obviously I've fished a few venues now up and down the country, Westwood Lakes, tend to fish Tunnel Barn a bit now. But obviously the introduction of a big head of F1s here at Gold Valley, I've tended to fish for them a lot more now. And what you'll notice, fishing shallow is slightly different, but whether we're fishing soft pellets, maggots, paste, I try to do everything as close to me as possible. And like I say, that really does speed you up. But speed isn't the most important thing when you're fishing paste at close quarters. One of the most important things is being able to see what your float's doing. Once it dibs and goes, or just rockets under, you can see if it carries on going, then I'm going to strike. If it stops and just starts to come back up, I'm not going to strike. And by not striking at these false indications and bites, obviously then you're going to speed yourself up, because you're just leaving it in then. Quite often you'll get it'll go under and you can see the float stop and it comes back up, so it's an obvious liner. That one then, it went under and just carried on going. But what I'm trying to say is by not striking at those false bites, those ones that go under, stop and come up, quite often then it goes and you catch one. And that was a liner that you've had. Another decent F1. A real mixture of sizes here. That's a lovely looking fish as well. Fantastic. And you can see quite often, not just here, but on a lot of F1 venues, you might not catch at this range all day. But what you could well do is either get off to a fantastic start or have a fantastic ending. And you see the size of these F1s, beautiful markings on that one. Fantastic fish. Just over a pound. And like I say, you can really, really rattle a weight together. Speed. I've got that little bit of paste that I moulded up whilst I was waiting for that bite. It's on the hook. It's back in. Pick the catapult up as the float's settling. Few pellets. Feed that line. Then with the left hand, I'm making up another little bit of paste. It's trying to be as fast and efficient as you can. If I do wait a little bit longer for a bite on that paste, maybe I make two or three up. It just gets me ahead of myself. Float's just dinking away all the time. But because I'm fishing close to myself and I can see what that float's doing under the water, I had a two or three little dibs there, which I definitely would have struck at if I was fishing on a longer pole. But I could see the float just stopped and then the float came back up. And these aren't bites that you're going to hook. These are line bites. There's a lot of fish in your peg. And it really is a fantastic way of fishing. It's something that I noticed a few of the lads doing. Les in particular at Tunnel Barney. Fishes really close to himself with paste. And I know he's quite a shrewd angler. And you ask him about it and he might not sort of tell you the exact important things. But I watched him once when I was doing a teaching there. And I could see exactly what he was doing. Very, very clever. Bringing it close to yourself. You can see you're not striking at false bites. And by having a go with it myself and doing what, trying to mimic what he was doing, I could really see the advantages of what he was doing. Obviously, there's some days you'll start at this distance and it just won't happen. Just keep a little bit of bait going in, little indication then. And there we go. Saw that float. It dibbed two or three times, which I probably would have struck at. It's only one of the smaller F1s. Beautiful fishing. I can really see the advantages of fishing really close to yourself. Well, that paste line's gone a little bit quiet and I'm going to go out shallow. We've been feeding it. And I'm just going to fold that rig over three times. The third time, leave it. And hopefully we should catch a few shallow just to keep the... Had a bite then immediately, which is a fantastic sign. Keep turning that rig over, using that hook bait to make some noise. There's definitely some fish there. Hopefully we'll catch some fish, which will be a just reward really for constantly feeding it. There we go, we got one straight away. Missed the bite. Looks like an F1. And again, when you're feeding and fishing shallow, it's important to be fast, but what I like to do a lot of the time is get my fish halfway back. I can wedge it in the guru pole sock and then just carry on shipping back. See, I can keep feeding. It's very important to, it's not really about volume, it's about regularity. You see there, nice big F1. Fantastic. Just pop the hook out. As you might have noticed, I've started on the conventional rig. Always like to do that. I've not really fished a jigger here at Gold Valley an awful lot, but I am convinced it will work. Always want to start on the conventional rig and then change. So three turns over, then I'm looking to pick my catapult up and feed. Not loads of pellets, just 10 or 12 pellets around my float. Try and get them just short. Turn your rig over again. Really is about working hard. Good little thing. There's a bite there then, so I'm going to feed. Turn my rig over three times. I won't always do it three times. If I miss a bite, I quite like then, I'll just lift it and drop it from a height. There was a bite then immediately. Just to start with, three rotations is a good number. Well, it's probably a good time for me to talk to you about the depths. As you heard me mention, they're set at two different depths. One's at a foot, one's at 16 inches. They're the two depths that I really do like to catch at. Good friends of mine that do a lot of F1 fishing, it's a favourite depth of theirs. And it's just a depth that's fantastic to have two rigs set up as. You can see we're catching quite well. But I missed three or four bites before, and that's what the jigger cuts out. You're not striking at any false indications. So again, I'm just pop my pole in the guru pole sock, which grips it fantastically. The cloud tops really are fantastic. And these short tops really do make you fast and efficient. One thing you will notice, not just here but on a lot of venues, the quality of the fish, if you catch them shallow, are obviously a lot bigger. Like I say, it's all about speed, regularity of feed. You can see I stop a little way out, ping a few pellets. You've got to keep that regularity of feed. Keep these F1s in your peg. Don't get a bite, just lift it out, flick it over. I'm just flicking it over once at a time now. If I don't get any signs, like now, it's been a bit quiet. One, two, three. There we go, we got one straight away. It's all about creating that noise, regularity of feed. And like I say, you've got to keep that going to keep these F1s in your peg. Very easy to slacken off and not work as hard as you possibly should be working, and you get a lot less fish in your peg then. It really is a case. It's a little bit like pellet waggler fishing, you know. The people that work the hardest that are never, you know, when you look at them, they're either casting, reeling in, feeding or playing a fish. They're never sat there. And it's the same as this, all shallow fishing, a lot of it really is about work rate. And quite often the busiest anglers are the ones that are weighing the decent nets of fish at the end. You can't ping all the time, but just make little windows, because what I've done then is I've pinged some pellets, and quite often you'll go out, flick your rig in once, and the fish has come to those loose. I missed the bite then. And what I'm trying to do is to use my rig. All the time I'm getting lots of bites, I'll only flick it over once. You can see there, I missed another bite, flick it over once. And again, another bite. Flick it over once. As soon as it goes quiet, I'll rotate my rig three times just to create that noise. Plenty of bites there now. Unbelievable how many bites you actually can miss. They're finicky fish, these little F1s and these carp. Fantastic fishing though. You've got to be busy. Your work rate's got to be high. And you can quite often reap the rewards just by working harder than most anglers, by feeding more regular. It's not necessarily about piling baiting. But I'm missing a few bites, and I think it's a fantastic opportunity for me to try that jigger and just see if I can convert. The thing is with it, because you're holding a tight line, you're not necessarily striking at bites. Your elastic's just going to come out. And that is the beauty with the jigger. It can really transform a lot of bites and odd fish into a lot of fish, and that's what you're looking to do. You're looking for little edges all the time. What I'm going to do, pop that one in the net, and I'm going to try the jigger. Well, there we go, still fishing shallow, and the jigger really has, you know, been noticeably better. I think the main reason is you're fishing all the time. You're waiting for the fish to hook itself, and you're fishing all the time. You're not striking at false bites. And like I say, not only has it been deadly at other venues, but it appears very, very good here. I'm just loose feeding, and then just trying to follow the pellets down with the jigger. Like I say, you can fish at a variety of different depths, but the main thing is you're always holding a very tight line to the float and the bait. So if one does take it, it's going to hook itself. All I do is loose feed, bring the rig back up, try to imagine the way those pellets are falling, trying to get my hook bait to go down at the same rate. It's just about you know, just pinging around your float, and just imagine the way those pellets are falling down and trying to get your hook bait to fall at the same rate. Missed the bite then. For the striking, you just, like then, you just lift when one's actually hooked itself. But all you're doing, because the jigger's free running, is you're using that to fish at a variety of different depths. But also, if you can imagine, when your loose feed hits the water and starts to sink, if you can time it right so that your hook bait's in amongst them, your chances of getting a bite is unbelievably big, you know. Also, you can see the size of the fish is much bigger. Basically, the best way I've found with the jigger is to go out there, and what I'm going to do is to create some noise with my float. And what this does, it buys me a little window. 1, 2, 3. Now I could hook one now off the noise of the float like that, but also it gives me time to pick my catapult up, feed, and if I didn't hook one on that first 3 splashes, I can then lift my bait and then lower it back down. And that's the sort of sequence. A lot of my shallow fishing is done in sequences. You might remember when we fished the pellet waggler. It's cast, hold the rod, nothing, reel in, put the rod down, feed, reel in, cast again, hold the rod, nothing, reel in, feed, reel in, cast again. And it's all about repeating the same processes, and you've got to work very, very hard. You saw even before we went on this shallow rig just how much effort we put into feeding, and you can see the size of these F1s. They're literally on average probably twice the size, hooked perfectly in the top lip, and that fish has, like I say, hooked itself. So again, the process that I'm using, I'll ship out. Hopefully I don't get one straight away. So I'll make a bit of noise with the float, hold that there when I might get one now. But what that enables me to do is to pick my catapult up. I can feed around the float, then I can lift it back up, and then I can lower it down the same rate as those pellets are falling through the water, and that gives me a massive chance of catching one. If I don't get one, again, 1, 2, 3, hold it there, I could get one. Had a bite then. What you've got to try and do, the pellets have just landed, I'm going to let those go down with the pellets at the same rate. There you go. Perfectly hooked. Absolutely bang on. One thing I made a mistake then, that you've got to get out of the habit with the jigger, is striking. It's very easy when that float goes, just out of knee-jerk reaction, to actually strike. But the fish are going to hook themselves. That's the difference with this jigger. You can see when you've got a lot of fish in your peg, just how deadly it is. They're bigger fish, they're them big F1s. It's one of those methods. I think you can see now the reason why I was almost hell bent on showing you this and the pace short, because it's a combination of methods, a bit like the bomb and the waggler. If you can get them working in harmony together, you're going to be very, very hard to beat. And that is what match fishing's about. It's about getting edges, getting very good at. So I'm going to turn that rig over. 1, 2, 3. Hold that rig there. I could get one, but if I don't, it gives me that window to feed. Lift the rig up, lower it down with those pellets that are falling through the water, and bang. See then? That one just pulled off, but again, I'm just going to repeat the process. 2, 3, hold the float there. If I don't get one, which we've got one, but it still enables me to feed for the next cast. It really is a case of, it's more of a method where you've got to get good at it. I like to follow the same process all the time. I've watched some good anglers at this, and one of the best shallow anglers in the country, Steve Openshaw, I actually went and watched him at Tunnel Barn on the Darwa Masters when I was doing some filming for Darwa, and I learnt more about that style of fishing in 10 minutes just watching him, watching the process. And like I say, that was a while ago now, but just by watching and learning, you come away, and it's amazing what you can actually pick up. So 1, 2, 3, hold the float. I'm not even looking, I'm looking at my catapult. If one does take it, it's going to hook itself. I can feed around the float, lift it up, and then just lower it down at the same rate those pellets are falling through the water. Looks so natural, missed the bite then. So I'm just going to drop it back in. There we go. Absolutely perfect. Such a deadly, deadly method. Now, we were catching quite well on the normal rig, but what the jigger does, it really enables you just to sit there and fish. Your bait's in the water 100% of the time because you're not missing bites, you're not striking at anything. The fish is hooking itself. It's one of those little methods that can really, really speed you up. Well, there we are, we've reached the end of the session, and it really has been a fantastic exercise. Right from the word go, we've managed to catch a few fish short on paste. And what I've really done is made the most of it by doing exactly what I said I was going to do and what I explained to you. When the float goes, I've just hesitated, and because you're almost above it, because it's so close, you can watch it, and then sometimes it just comes back up, which is obviously a liner. And then it goes, and then underneath the water, you can see it keep going, and they're the ones to strike at. If you're fishing out any further, obviously you haven't got the advantage of being able to see the float once it actually goes under. It really does make you faster and more efficient. All the time we were fishing there, I started the session kinder cupping a few micros just to get some fish there. When the fish were there, literally just used the paste on the hook. The odd bite I did miss was deposited on the bottom. You get a little bit of ground bait coming off the paste, and this is enough to keep the fish there. You don't want to overfeed them. All the time we were fishing there, we were pinging pellets at 14.5 metres, ready to go shallow. It went a little bit funny, but I do think we'd have carried on catching on pace short, purely because we got a lot of room today. But I saw a couple of little swirls out long, went out long on the standard rig, which is the KC Shelf, the 4B12. Was missing a lot of bites, catching a few, but I thought, I just had this sneaky suspicion after using that jigger on a variety of venues, that that was really going to catch some fish. Went out on it, and to be honest, it was like switching the light on. Didn't miss any bites. You've got to get in the rhythm of not striking. You're only going to lift the pole when the elastic's actually out. The main thing to get in the sort of habit of doing was loose feeding. And if you can imagine there, your pellets from your loose feed is lowering your jigger pellet down with it. And if I got that timing right, I caught one every single chuck. It really was like shelling peas. You can make a bit of noise, and you can fish at a couple of different depths. If it is allowed on your venue, an odd venue does ban it, one reason or another. It's allowed here. If it is allowed on your venue and there's some, it really does give you the advantage. And that's what I like about these F1s and small carp. If you get a little edge, you're going to be very, very hard to beat. And the two methods that I've shown you today will definitely give you an edge. Just one other thing. When you're fishing with banded pellets, I've actually ended up on a varnish pellet, which is one that's actually tied on a noose and varnished on. It lasts a lot longer. But when you're catching a lot of fish and you're fishing with banded 4s or 6 mils, get yourself a pellet bander. I thought they were a little bit gimmicky, but I'm telling you now, when your hands are wet and slimy, if you're catching a lot of fish, it's virtually impossible on those small bands to get the pellet on. And a pellet bander really will speed things up again. Take your time, do a few banded pellets, do a few varnished pellets, like I say, and that if you can catch on them, if the fish are really having it like they have been today, it can really speed you up and put you ahead of the opposition. So like I say, there's a couple of little methods that I know are catching me a lot of fish and standing me in good stead, and I'm sure they'll do the same for you. We have caught quite a lot of fish today, and in a minute I'll put a few of them back towards the end because the nets were getting reasonably full. There is a 50 pound net limit here, and I'm sure we're very close to that. We're going to have a little look at the fish that we've caught today and then pop them back. Well, there you go. That's a small part of what we've managed to catch today. Some real nice, decent size F1s. That paste fished at close quarters is absolutely massive. You can see the float going under. You can hesitate and let it really go. Fantastic little way of fishing. It's going to be an absolutely deadly method in the next month or so. Coupled with fishing shallow, that constant feeding and definitely having a go on that jigger. Two methods that I know have done me very, very well in the past. They really are going to come to the fore. A lot of good anglers are on it already. And I hope showing you those two methods today gives you that little bit of an edge.